Hello friends, today's lecture is on payment design. I am Aman Jain, Assistant Professor, Department of Civil Engineering, Sarparampat Singhania University. The contents of today's lecture will be the introduction to payment design, where we will know about overview, requirements of a payment, types of payment, flexible, rigid, then summary, and then we will go through some problems about the lecture which we studied today, which we are going to study today. So let's take a quick overview about the highway payment. That what is a highway payment? A highway payment is a structure consisting of superimposed layers of processed materials above the natural soil subgrade, whose primary function is to distribute the applied vehicle loads to the subgrade. Okay, so highway grade is a structure consisting of superimposed layers, and the important thing is that the layers which are superimposed over one another are made up of processed material. The processed material may be your concrete, it may be stone pillars, it may be aggregates of different shapes and different sizes, which are designed after gradation. Okay, so and the next thing, the payment structure should be able to provide a surface acceptable riding quality, adequate skid resistance, favorable light reflecting characteristics, and low noise pollution. The ultimate aim is to ensure that the transmitted stresses due to wheel load are sufficiently reduced so that they will not exceed the bearing capacity of the subgrade. Yes, to design any type of pavement, one should know the bearing capacity of the subgrade, and it should be designed in such a way. The pavement should be designed in such a way that transmitted stresses, which are ultimate transmitted stresses to the subgrade, should not be more than the bearing capacity of the subgrade, because the subgrade is also known as the foundation, and on which the above layers are resting. And if by chance subgrade fails, your highway also get fails. Two types of payments are generally recognized as serving this purpose, namely flexible and rigid payments. This presentation gives an overview of payment types, layers, and their functions and payment failures. Okay, improper designs of payments leads to early failures of payment, affecting its riding quality. Now let's study about what are the requirements of a payment. Requirements of the payment means what does an ideal payment have in it. So an ideal payment should meet the following requirements: sufficient thickness to distribute the wheel load stresses to a safe value on the subgrade soil, structurally strong to withstand all types of stresses imposed upon it, adequate coefficient of friction to prevent skidding of vehicles. Yes, this may not be happen because from skidding there are chances of accidents. Smooth surface to provide comfort to road users even at high speed, reduce least noise from the moving vehicle because it is the cause for sound pollution and discomfort among the passengers and all the stakeholders of the highway. So, and dust proof surface so that the traffic safety is not impaired by reducing its visibility. So the material should be such that it should not produce any type of dust, and it should not go into the eyes of the driver or the passengers, so that it not be it may not reduce the visibility of the highway stakeholders. Imperviousness, impervious surface, so that the subgrade soil is well protected and long design life with low maintenance cost. So these are the requirements, these were the requirements of the an ideal pavement, and an ideal pavement should meet all the following requirements. Now let's jump over to the types of pavement. What are the different types of pavement? So there are two types of pavement mainly. The pavements can be classified based on the structural performance into two. First is flexible pavement and the second one is rigid pavement. In flexible pavements, wheel loads are transferred by grain to grain. Yes, this one is important. How wheel loads are transferred? Wheel loads are transferred in flexible pavement by grain to grain contacts of the aggregate to the granular structure. This is important. The load transfer is the thing. The flexible pavement having less flexural strength acts like flexible sheet, just like your bituminous roads. It is like flexible sheet only. On the contrary, in rigid pavements, wheel loads are transferred to subgrade soil by flexural strength of the pavement, and the pavement is acts like as a rigid plate. Yes, this is a rigid plate, and this is a sheet. Where is the sheet? This is the sheet. So this acts like a sheet. If you can visualize the difference between a sheet and a plate, you can easily visualize the load transfer of load from the upper layer to the lower layer of the let's the example is of cement concrete roads. In addition to these, there are some composite pavements are also available. Let me rough out this. In addition to this, there are many composite pavements. Thin layer of flexible pavement or rigid pavement is an ideal pavement, which is most desirable characteristics. However, such pavements are rarely used in new construction because of high cost and complex analysis required. So we are not using this type of composite pavements. We are only using mostly this among us two type of pavement, which are rigid and flexible. Let's go in deep about the flexible pavement in the next slides. Flexible pavements will transmit wheel load stresses to the lower layers, as said before, that they are transferring the load by grain to grain transfer to the points of contact. In the granular structure. The structure is granular. In the next slide, I'll show you some slides in which the granular structure is there and shown in a very good way. The wheel load acting on the pavement will be distributed to a wider area and the stresses decrease with the depth. Taking advantage of this stress distribution characteristics, flexible pavements normally has many layers. It has many layers as compared to a rigid pavement. In rigid pavements there are only two or three layers, but in this there are many layers, layers over layers. So hence the design of flexible pavement uses the concept of a layered system. This is the important thing, and this has to be remembered. Based on this, flexible pavement may be constructed in a number of layers, and the top layer has to be of the best quality to sustain maximum compressive stress in addition to wear and tear. So upper layer is known as wearing layer. We are calling the upper layer wearing surface layer or wearing surface force, because it contains the most of the wear and tear. Most of the wear and tear is applied only to the above surface of the pavement, and most of the compressive stresses are coming directly to the above layer. So let us look at the load transfer in granular structure. This is a V load. It may be considered as P, no problem. You may consider it anyway, any other thing also. This is the granular structure. This is the granular structure of a rigid pavement, and this is how the load will get transferred. From here, the load is coming, and this is the point of contact. This is the point of contact. These are the points of contact. This is like point of contact from where the load is being transferred to the subsequent layers. So this is the important diagram which is showing that how it is transferred. This is the load. This is the wheel load. This is the wheel, and this is the granular structure of a flexible pavement. The lower layer, as compared to upper layers, will experience lesser magnitude of stress, and low quality material can be used. So, as we are going from top to bottom in subsequent layers, the quality of materials which we are using may be of low quality. It may be remembered that always in above layers, in the top layers of the highway, we are using the best quality materials which we can use as per our economic conditions. Flexible pavements are constructed using bituminous materials. These can be either in the form of surface treatments, such as bituminous surface treatments, generally found on low volume roads, or asphalt concrete surface courses, generally used on high volume roads such as national highways. So these are two examples. Flexible pavement layers reflect the deformation of the lower layers onto the surface layer. If there is any undulation in the subgrade, then it will be transferred to the surface layer. So it should be remembered that if there is any undulation in the bottom layer, it will be transferring to above layer. It's like this, that if this is the surface layer, and these are the subsequent layers, and this is the bottomest layer. This means it is a subgrade, and this is subgrade, and this is surface course, surface layer. And if there is any undulation, if it is the original, this is the original layer, and if there is any undulation, if it is like this one, then it will be subsequently transferred to the above layers. So it will be like this. So there will be some space here, some groove here. So this is like that. In the case of flexible pavement, the design is based on overall performance of flexible pavement, and the stresses are produced should be kept well below the allowable stresses of each pavement layer. This is the typical cross section of flexible pavement. I was talking about the layers in previous slides, that a typical flexible pavement is containing many layers as compared to rigid pavement. So this is the natural subgrade, which is acting as a natural foundation for flexible pavement. This is compacted subgrade, which we are compacting subgrade and making a foundation, or it is like foundational like structure for a flexible pavement. Then comes after this compacted subgrade of up to 300 mm of compacted subgrade. Then comes sub base course of 100 to 300 mm. The base course is of again 100 to 300 mm. Binder course is also of 50 to 100 mm. And the surface course is up to 50 mm. 25 to 50 mm we can use the surface course. Above the base course, we are doing this prime coat here. We are applying a layer of tech coat on this binder course and a layer of steel coat on the surface course. We will study in detail that why these layers are applied, what is the reason, and in subsequent slides we will study in detail that why this all thing is done. So there are few types of flexible pavement. The following types of construction have been used in flexible pavement. First is the conventional use, conventional layered flexible pavement. The second one is full depth asphalt pavement, and the third one is cram is new, known as contained rock asphalt mat. So what are these? Let's have a look at on this. Conventional flexible pavements are layered systems with high quality expensive materials are placed on top. As I said in before slide, that high quality materials are always on the top and inferior quality materials are in the bottom layers, are placed in the bottom layers. So expensive materials are placed in the top where stresses are high, and low quality cheap materials are placed into the lower layers. Full depth asphalt pavements are constructed by placing bituminous layers directly on the soil subgrade. This is more suitable when there is high traffic and local materials are not available. In this conventional flexible material, conventional pavement, we are using those materials which are locally available. Most of the materials which are used, which are locally available and cheap, we are using those materials in conventional flexible pavements. But in this full depth asphalt pavements, we are constructing this by placing bituminous layers directly over the soil, natural soil subgrade, where we are only using the bituminous layers. This is more suitable when there is high traffic and local materials are not available. Contained rock asphalt mats are constructed by placing dense open graded aggregate layers between two asphalt layers. Modified dense graded asphalt concrete is placed above the subgrade, which significantly reduces the vertical compressive strength on the soil subgrade and protect from surface water. So where surface water is more, we can use this cram type of flexible pavement. Typical layers of flexible pavement, as we discussed, steel coat, surface coat, tech coat, binder coat, prime coat, base coat, sub base coat, compacted subgrade, and natural subgrade. Let's go into a bit little in detail of this all layers. What are they? The steel coat is a thin surface treatment used to waterproof the surface and to provide skid resistance. Tech coat is a very light application of asphalt. Usually asphalt emulsions diluted with water. It provides proper bonding between two layers of binder coat and must be thin, uniformly cover the entire surface and set very fast. Prime coat is an application of low viscous cutback bitumen to an absorbent surface like granular basis on which binder layer is placed. It provides bonding between two layers, unlike tech coat, and prime coat penetrates into the layer below and plugs the voids and forms the watertight surface. So these were steel coat, tech coat, and prime coat. All materials are like coating. This is a surface course. Surface course is the layer directly in contact with traffic loads and generally contains superior quality materials. They are used usually constructed with dense graded asphalt concrete. The functions and requirements of the layers are, it provides characteristics such as friction, smoothness and drainage, etc. Also, it will prevent the entrance of excessive quantities of surface water into the underlying base, subbase and subgrade. So it is very important that surface core should be watertight. It must be tough to resist distortion under traffic and provide a smooth and skid resistance riding surface. So this is the most important surface of any road, because the riding quality which every stakeholder or every driver uses the road and evaluate the same upon it. So this is the important one, that the surface course should be tough and should be such that it should take as much as designed stresses on it. It must be waterproof to protect the entire base and subgrade from the weakening effect of water. Then comes binder cores. This layer provides the bulk of asphalt concrete structure. It is its chief purpose is to distribute load to the base course. The binder cores generally consist of aggregates having less asphalt, and doesn't require quality as high as the surface course. So replacing a part of surface course by binder course results in more economical design. So we are sometimes doing the same design where we are replacing a part of surface course by the binding course and for some economical designs also. So when we will be studying the design of this pavement, we will be looking on this criteria, because we are engineers and we have to be economical also at the same time. Base course. The base course is the layer of material immediately beneath the surface of binder course, and it provides the additional load distribution and contribute to the subsurface drainage. It may be composed of crushed stones, crushed slag and other untreated or stabilized materials. Subbase course. The subbase course is the layer of material beneath the base course, and the primary functions are to provide structural support, improve drainage and reduce the intrusion of fines from the subgrade in the pavement structure. If the base course is open graded, then the subbase course with more fines can serve as a filler between subgrade and the base course. The subbase course is not always needed for to use. Sometimes we may avoid designing if the design requirements are not there. We may not use this subbase course. Actually, if at all it is required, then only we are using this subbase course. Otherwise, we are not using it in design. For example, a pavement, get a clear picture of this. That why we should use and why we should not use this layer. For example, a pavement constructed over high quality stiff subgrade may not need additional features offered by a subgrade course. In such situations, subbase course may not be provided. There is an extra, you may understand this principle or this fact by this thing, that if the roads are provided on roads are constructed on a hilly area or rocky region, so the surface is having rock, so the subgrade is already stiff. Then subbase course is no more required. And then comes the subgrade. The top soil or subgrade is the layer of natural soil prepared to receive the stresses from the layers above. It is essential that at no time soil subgrade is overstressed. This is the most important part. This is the main principle of this is the important principle, that soil subgrade should never be overstressed. over stress. It should be compacted to the desirable density near the optimum moisture content. Now let's come to rigid pavement, the another part. What is rigid pavement? Rigid pavements have sufficient flexural strength to transmit wheel load stresses to a wider area below. So this is typical rigid pavement, which is only having two layers. Only base of subbase, post and Portland cement concrete. There is no kind of other surface force in this. This is only the surface force, the PCC, Portland cement concrete. So a typical cross section of the rigid pavement is this. This is you may see the sizes 100 to 300 mm and 150 to 300 mm. Not more than any layer should not be more than 300 mm. Compared to flexible pavement, rigid pavements are placed either directly on the prepared subgrade or on a single layer of granular or stabilized material. Since there is only one layer of material between the concrete and the subgrade, this layer can be called as base or subbase. You may call it any. Here we go. In the rigid pavement, load is distributed by slab action and the pavement behaves like an elastic plate resting on a viscous medium. So this is the viscous foundation, this is the contact pressure, and this is the elastic plate, which is your layer of rigid pavement. So you may understand it very easily that this is behaving like a slab action. Rigid pavements are constructed by Portland cement concrete and should be analyzed by plate theory instead of layer theory. So these are analyzed by plate theory instead of layer theory. Layer theory is used in flexible pavements and the plate theory is used in this rigid pavements. Assuming an elastic plate resting on this foundation, so as we saw in this previous slide, assuming this this layer, this is the elastic plate and this is the viscous foundation. Plate theory is a simplified version of layer theory that assumes the concrete slab as a medium of thick plate which is plane before loading and to be remain plane after loading. Bending of the slab due to the wheel load and temperature variation and the resulting tensile and flexural stress. So there are just like flexible pavements and rigid pavements, there are also several types. JCP, JRC, PCRC, and PCB. JPCP is known as jointed plane concrete pavement. JRCP is known as joint reinforced concrete pavement. And CRCP is continuous reinforced concrete pavement. And pre-stressed concrete pavement is PCP. So let's look at the definitions of all this. JPCP are plain cement concrete pavements constructed with closely spaced contraction joints, dual parts or